So that brings us now to risk management. So now that we've actually set up the platform of where information security should be heading, we have already set up a team of people that should be looking into information security. We now look at a risk-based approach towards managing information security. So from the first phase, we call the first phase of security governance, we have actually said, this is my risk management framework, and these are risk acceptance criteria which have been signed off by the leadership team. So based on that, we now look at how do we actually manage that risk. So using ISO 31000, and I believe that across almost every other standard, they always refer back to ISO 31000 as well. It then provides you with the ability to come up with a framework to manage risk. Now, within the information security risk management framework, then you have your identification of your risk, your assessment of your risk, your evaluation of your risk, and then the treatment of your risk. Now, all that seems quite easy when you put it, okay, makes sense. But what we need to look now at, how do we actually come up with the measurements that will enable us first to assess, and how then are we able to treat your risk? Now, in many organizations, there is an enterprise risk management framework, or even if you do not have one, then it is always good to actually have a risk management framework in place. Now, where your organization actually already have an enterprise risk management framework, what we need to do is that taking the information security objective, which we have already outlined in the first phase in security governance, looking at the information security objective, align that back to the enterprise risk management framework. And then from there, we look at all the elements within the risk management framework as to populating how do you measure risk. So obviously, in risk assessment itself, you have the likelihood and the impact of a risk eventuating. And that should come up from your enterprise risk management framework. So how we always have said that every IT objective should be aligned to the corporate objective. In the same way, we say information security objectives needs to be aligned back to the enterprise risk management framework. So we go to the next. So from the information security risk management, if you look at the very first point, it says context establishment. Now, you would have noticed that a lot of this would have been already done upfront during the security governance phase. And that's why we are able to divide them the way we do. So the output from the context establishment then flows into this particular phase of information security risk management itself. So within the risk management framework, aside from the alignment of to the enterprise risk management framework, we need to have the understanding of risk governance around that. So who are the people who need to be involved within the risk management framework? We bring in people from the process, the business side. We bring in people from IT. Because if we look at information security, we're not just talking about IT security, we're talking about information security. So in an organization where there is, from the time that you collect your information, there are some manual representation of information, to some digitalization of that information, then it brings to cause that we look at both the manual information as well as IT side of the information. So when we talk about risk governance, we talk about bringing together the business component of a business as well as the IT component of the business to look at how we manage risk. So when we start to divide the boundaries of information security, we invite both the business people, whom we normally call as process owners, and we bring in the people of IT, which we normally call them enablers for or support team for the business, and we start running through the risk assessment with both teams. Now, coming out from that, we have to have an idea about how do we actually then interpret those risks. So the process owner obviously will understand what risk is to them. They will be able to have an understanding of the process. For you to be able to look at risk assessment, we must first understand what is your risk scenarios. So what does risk scenario means? And risk scenario is something that you can actually get out of COVID, the understanding out of the COVID practices as well. Risk scenario, basically what I like to call it, storytelling. So from understanding a process within an organization, you will be able to then understand what controls that you have in place. Where there is a lack of those controls, then what risk is presented from a lack of those controls. So from having identified a scenario of a risk, it becomes easier then to start understanding what is the likelihood of that risk actually even happening. And then what is the impact if it actually does eventuate? Without having an understanding of what risk scenario is, it becomes quite difficult for you to then identify what is the likelihood of it actually happening. And then from having an understanding of that, the next thing that we need to have an understanding about is how do you then measure? To what extent do you think a particular risk is low? What do you view as a risk is medium or high? So this is where a risk metrics table is really important. So how do we define a risk metrics table? And then coming back again to what we have obtained in the first stage of it is to look at what is defined in the enterprise risk management framework. So from there, you are able to then look at the identification of when a risk is low, is where an impact is low, or the likelihood of it happening being low as well. So what is important about a risk metrics table? The risk metrics table actually would tell you to what extent it becomes justifiable for you to actually implement a control. So if a control has got very low risk to an organization, it really doesn't make much sense for you to put in a lot of money into implementing a particular control. And vice versa, if a risk is really high, even though the likelihood of it actually happening is low, you want to put some controls in place and it's justifiable for you to put money into implementing those controls. And which is why we are saying is that why using a risk-based approach to managing information security makes more sense than just trying to implement security ad hocly across the organization. Because in many organizations where you're trying to run budgets, where you're trying to fight for resources, you're trying to fight for costing of money, you will find that in this type of situations, it is always good that you're able to prioritize your risk so that you can say that these are the things that I can do today, but these are the things that I can wait until later for us to do. Now, once we've run through the risk assessment and we've identified what are the things that we need to do now and what we need to do later, so what we need to do then for each one of those risks that you've identified is to look at what are the measurements that you can then put in place to look at how successful is a particular control that you have implemented. So for example, if we are saying that a particular control is to put a measurement to measure how many security incidents has happened in this period of time. So if we have measurements to say that the number of incidents that happen seems to have gone lower by the implementation of a particular control, then you can then report to management to say that it is a successful ISMS implementation, or sorry, a successful controls implementation. And from that, the reporting that needs to go to management provides a close of the loop to say that you have continuous improvement into your processes in the organization. So at the end of the day, when we talk about information security, we can put in a lot of processes, we can put in a lot of frameworks. Ultimately, whether an ISMS is successful or not, aside from the measurements that you see at the end of and at the end of that tunnel, is actually about the culture that we have created in terms of how do everyone in the organization view information security. Do I actually understand information security to the extent that every time I say, for example, every time I leave my table, I got to make sure that I've actually locked out my screen, to really actually doing it all the time that I actually walk out of my table, I actually lock out the screen. So a lot of the time, awareness is good, but we have also found out that along with awareness, there is always the contributory factor about the culture that you inculcate in everyone in the organization. So ultimately, why we do ISMS is that not only to improve the processes, to increase and heighten your information security, but at the end of the day, you want to create an awareness of information security across the organization.